Good evening. May I be one among the first to wish you a Merry Christmas Eve. So glad that you've chosen to join us at Atlanta First United Methodist Church on what has been a quite chaotic Christmas Eve here in the city of Atlanta. When you came in this evening, I have to be careful. Preachers are usually doing things in the morning, and so the one or two evenings a year just throws us off. I've been telling everybody good morning all evening. So when you came in this evening, hopefully you got a bulletin. And there was a small insert. One side says, "Welcome to Atlanta First," and there's an attendance registration there. If you're visiting with us for the first time this evening, we do pay a special welcome to you. Hope you'll find this a warm and inviting place to which you'll want to return often for worship and fellowship. And we'd ask that if you're so inclined, if you'd fill that out, place in the offering plate when it comes by a little later in the service. On the flip side, a couple opportunities to serve. Atlanta First is a church committed to serving in the city, and we will serve the first Tuesday in January at Safe House, where we offer dinner to folks who would not otherwise have dinner. And then Hospitality House, which is a place that hosts families who have loved ones in hospitals in the Decatur area. And so if that's a thing that you would enjoy, a couple opportunities to serve in the new year, and we see that there. Also have a little information there about the Atlanta First Day School. We are in our fifth year. Had our fifth birthday at the Atlanta First Day School. It's a wonderful, wonderful ministry of the church. And if you have family or friends who have children in the city who are in need of wonderful, quality educational child care with a Christian emphasis, then we have a wonderful ministry of that going on as well. Just want to let you know that everything you should need from this point forward is in your bulletin to follow along. It'll be a wonderful night. The children are obviously in the worship service with us tonight, and none of them are going to bother me a bit. This is a time for us all to be together as a family, and we will just have a wonderful, wonderful time. Should have had a candle when you come in. We'll have the beautiful candlelight at the end of the service, and you'll be able to follow along. I'm so grateful tonight and honored to welcome the Reverend Dr. Coy Hinton to be with us. Coy and his family had, his last few years, Coy was the district superintendent of Atlanta College Park District and retired last year, and his family had honored me by the last several years. This had been the place that they had come for Christmas Eve. Now, I didn't put him to work then because he was generally just finishing up with church conference season and had enough of dealing. He just wanted to sit and rest, but when I thought he might be here this evening, I asked if he would come and serve with me tonight. So, Coy, so glad to have you this evening. So glad to see so many familiar faces and friends. It's a wonderful, wonderful night. Those who know me well know that this is my favorite night of the year in church. And so will you join with me now as we prepare our hearts and minds for our worship of God. Beloved in Christ, we come by this service to prepare ourselves to hear again the message of the angels, and to go in heart and mind to Bethlehem, and to see the loving kindness of our God and the babe lying in a manger. Let us therefore open the Holy Scripture and read the earliest tale of that disobedience to God's holy will, which is common to us all, and then the story of the birth of Jesus Christ our Lord to save us from our sins and make us pure and happy, and let us thank him with our carols of praise. But first, let us pray for the needs of this whole world, and especially for peace and goodwill among all people, that they may learn to love one another as children of one God and Father of all. And because this would most rejoice his heart, let us remember before him the poor and the helpless, the cold, the hungry, and the oppressed, the sick and those who mourn, the lonely and the unloved, the aged and the little children, and all who know not the Lord Jesus or who love him not, who by their sins have grieved his heart. Lastly, let us remember before God all those who rejoice with us, but upon another shore and in a greater light, that multitude no one can number, with whom in this Lord Jesus we evermore are one. Amen.
Comfort, comfort, come, my people, tell of peace, O Savior.
be seated. When I became the pastor of Atlanta First United Methodist Church, I learned that one of the greatest traditions is that the senior pastor and his or her family are called upon to light the Christ candle on Christmas Eve. So it's great joy that I invite my family to come forward now as we relight our first four candles and light the Christ candle on this beautiful Christmas Eve night.
We began our journey a little over 3.5 weeks ago. We had just finished our Thanksgiving celebrations when we gathered for the first Sunday of Advent. Our tree was bare and the wreaths and garland had not yet been hung. We lit the first candle in hope that Christ would come again into our chaotic world. When we gathered the following Sunday, our tree was fully adorned with symbols of Christ and the lights twinkled from the carefully hung wreaths and garland. We lit the second candle to remind us to love God and to love each other. On the third Sunday, we were greeted with the crimson blossoms of the poinsettias. We lit the third candle as we were challenged to be joyful in all things. This past Sunday, we lit our fourth candle, remembering that through God, we can live in peace and at peace. And tonight, we light the Christ candle. Christ is our hope. Christ showed us the meaning of true love. In Christ, we find limitless joy. And if the world would fully know and follow Christ, we could finally live in peace and at peace with God in each other. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness will not overcome it.
Hear now the reading of the Old Testament lesson as it's recorded in the book of the prophet Isaiah, chapter 9. Verses 2 through 7. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. You have multiplied the nation, you have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as people exult when dividing plunder. For the yoke of their burden and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor you have broken as on the day of Midian. For all the boots of the tramping warriors and all the garments rolled in blood shall be burned as fuel for the fire. For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time onward and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
you have children with you this evening, I would love for you to let them come spend a few minutes with me. As the children are coming too, one thing I failed to ask you to do, and it's good because some more people have gathered with us. A couple of things I'd ask you to do. One is if you go find our Facebook page and like it, and you can, it's Atlanta First in Atlanta. There's one in Atlanta, Georgia. There's one in Texas also. But find the one that's got a beautiful picture of our church. Check in, like it, and let others know about what's going on in the life of Atlanta First United Methodist Church. Well, good evening, friends. So is something going on tonight? What is it? It's Christmas. Christmas Eve. Is someone, y'all planning for somebody to visit tonight? Who do you think? Who's that? Santa Claus? So a lot going on tonight, right? It's a busy, busy night, a special night. And maybe nothing more special than to see all the children lined up along the altar rail. So let me tell you something. We're going to learn. You're going to hear a little bit more about it in the sermon in a few minutes. How many of you like to get good news? We all like to get good news. How many of you like to share good news? I love to share good news. Good news is fun, right? It's like you got good grades at school. You can't wait to get home and tell somebody you got some good grades, right? Or if you got a trophy in a sport, you want to share that with everybody, right? I know I've got at least, how many of you are Girl Scouts up here? I got to see where my dealers are. I've got one right here. I know that you've won some awards selling cookies. There's all kind of good news to share. Well, if you've ever heard the word gospel, the gospels are Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And the gospel is the story of Jesus. And the word gospel means good news. And one of the most important things God asks us to do is to share the good news of God and Jesus with the world. And so that's all I'm asking of you tonight. As you go home, I hope that you have a wonderful Christmas day. I hope that your day is filled with wonderful things you love. More importantly, I hope it's filled with wonderful people who you love and that you share some special times with those special people. So will y'all bow your heads with me this evening and will you pray with me? Repeat after me. Dear God, thank you for the good news of the birth of your Son who came into the world to teach us how to love you and to love each other. We come this evening to celebrate the Christ child, in whose name we pray. Amen. All right, y'all can return and sit with your parents. This will be the best place for me to do this. I did mention earlier that today has been a chaotic day in our city across the southeast. Yesterday in Mississippi, folks lost their lives in the midst of these storms. And then in our own neighborhood in the city, we've had several creeks to flood and families to be washed out of their homes. This is a very difficult night for folks as it is, but certainly a difficult night to know that folks will be without all the things that they had gathered and all that they had hoped for tomorrow. So let's have a quick word of prayer as we prepare to receive our Christmas Eve offering. Oh God, as we come into the midst of this joyous night, as we come to celebrate the birth of the Christ child, we are also mindful that there are those who this night are in difficult circumstances. We recognize that there are those throughout the world who are in need of our prayers and in need of our love. God, we thank you for the blessing of Christmas, and we come now to return to you just a small portion of all that's been given to us, the greatest gift the world has ever known, life, not just now, but forever. through the birth of Christ, being reconciled to you forever. God bless this time together, our rest of our time together this evening, and bless these gifts as we receive them, for we offer them in the name of Christ our Lord. Amen.
Mary, did you know that your baby boy will someday walk on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will save our sons and daughters? Did you know your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you delivered will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know? Did you know that your baby boy will give sight to a blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will calm a storm with his hand? Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? And when you kiss your little baby, you've kissed the face of God. Mary, did you?
So proof that, not that y'all needed any proof, that my wife has more power than I do. That was her request that Ariel sing that this evening. And so always beautiful. And I failed to mention we have Hannah back tonight as our guest cellist. So good to have you. And so grateful for this incredibly gifted group of men and women who lead us in worship every Sunday. If this is your first time to visit with us, it's this good every Sunday. I promise. It's awesome. We would love to have you come and join us any Sunday and hear this incredible music. Our gospel lesson this evening is one which is very familiar. It's familiar in the sacred, in the secular world, just as it is in the sacred world. And so I ask if you will stand with me as you're able now, as we hear together once again these beautiful words from the greatest story ever told, as Luke shares it with us in his gospel, the second chapter, beginning in the first verse. And it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. And this taxing was first made when Quirinius was governor of Syria. And all went to be taxed, every one into his own city. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth, to Judea, unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, being great with child. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. And there were in that same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. You shall find a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. And it came to pass, as the angels were gone away from them into heaven, the shepherds said one to one another, Let us go even now unto Bethlehem, and to see this thing which has come to pass, which the Lord hath made known unto us. And they came with great haste and found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in a manger. And when they had seen it, they made known abroad the saying which was told to them concerning this child. And all they that heard it wondered at those things which were told to them by the shepherds. But Mary, she kept all of these things and pondered them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen, just as it had been told unto them. The gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be pleasing and acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Atlanta is amazing for so many reasons, and those who know me know that I was born and raised in this great city. And one of the things that makes Atlanta great is the number of pioneers we've had in our great city. Certainly, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was a great pioneer in the civil rights movement, someone who took the concept of nonviolent social change to a new level and changed the course of our country's history and really the course of human history. To calm myself down this afternoon, I went in and got myself a Coca-Cola. Certainly, Mr. Pemberton and those who were stewards and trustees of the Coca-Cola brand to this day revolutionized a whole market around fizzy sugar water. A couple guys thought it would be pretty cool if you could buy really good stuff for your house at a really cheap price. and Arthur Blank and Bernie Marcus revolutionized the way that we do it ourselves at our home, repair our homes, take care of our homes. In many ways, they revolutionized retail and spurred on the advent of the big box store. And yes, those who know me will know this is a little self-serving, but there was a gentleman named Truett Cathy whose sister worked at Greenbrier Mall, and he had this new product he had originally called the chicken steak sandwich. By the time he opened the first Chick-fil-A in Greenbrier Mall, he had perfected the recipe. If anyone's ever eaten at a food court, it's because Truett Cathy pioneered the concept. And if you came in off the interstate this evening, and I promise this is going to make sense in a minute. If you came in off the interstate this evening, you came up Ivan Allen Boulevard and you crossed over what had been historic Spring Street, which is now Ted Turner Drive. Ted Turner revolutionized the world. When I was a kid, we had 2, 5, 11, and 17. And Channel 17 brought to us America's team, the Braves. And the reason that the Braves were America's team was because he had inherited his father's billboard company. And he invested $2.5 million in a failing television channel. He bought that antenna and he began to broadcast. And he needed content, and so he brought the Braves because he knew he would have 162 days a year that he would have content for this. But Ted Turner was one of those people who can see into the future. And along with HBO, TBS, the superstation, was the first national cable television channel. Not to rest on his laurels, he had this crazy idea that people might want to watch news 24 hours a day. And so, once again, he risked everything he had. And he started CNN. He bought out the old Omni International Hotel. He moved his headquarters there. A hotel that had never been successful was suddenly successful. And the former home of Sid and Marty Croft. How many went to that were lived in Atlanta? We've got some old Atlantans here. Became the worldwide headquarters of the first 24-hour news network. Now, the reason I arrived at all of this was that I had this memory in the early 80s of a TV magazine show. And that TV magazine show was called Good News. It was actually launched after Turner had launched CNN. And it was to be something that would kind of complement what was happening on CNN. In the news business, the common idiom in the news business is if it bleeds, it leads. Turner wanted something to balance that with, and so he came up with this show named Good News. Liz Wickersham, a former Miss Georgia, hosted the show, and the entire purpose of the show was to share good news. They would take any story they could, and they would try to share the good news angle from it. Doing the research for this sermon led to some pretty interesting findings. One, about the time that Good News premiered, was when Lee Iacocca was helping Chrysler to emerge from bankruptcy, having paid back over 2/3 of the loans that were made to the suffering automaker. And then I learned a total random piece of trivia. Has nothing to do with the sermon or Christmas. But do you know who was the co-writer co-producer and director of the movie Staying Alive? Does anybody know that? Someone today I told this knew this. Sylvester Stallone. His brother apparently was one of the people who sang the songs in Staying Alive. Our story tonight is a story of good news. Now, the fact of the matter is there's some difficult news in this story as well, because for many generations, preachers, rightfully so, have acknowledged the fact that this was a young man and a young woman who had to travel under difficult circumstances. Extremely difficult circumstances, with her about to deliver her baby any day, forced by the government to go many miles from one place to another. The taxing was an oppressive tax. The whole process was something that represented the very worst of humankind. But tonight, I want us to celebrate and to focus on the good news. As I shared with the children earlier, the word gospel, that word, the capital G gospel, which is the gospel of Christ, comes from the Old English gold spell, which means good news. The Greek word meant good message. Now, I read from the King's English this evening, and it said good tidings. I read from the King's English because if it was good enough for Linus, it's good enough for me. But in the New Revised Standard Version, it is translated, I bring to you good news of great joy, which is for you and all people. This is truly good news that we should share with the world. Those who know me also know I'm fascinated by social media. It's impossible to navigate this world almost without some contact with social media, and it's also undeniable that social media has changed the world. There was a study done just a couple of years ago. Jonah Berger, who's a social psychologist at the University of Pennsylvania, set out to study social media, and what he did was he took the New York Times website and he studied over 6 months what stories were read and what stories were shared. And do you know what Dr. Berger found out? That good news spreads faster than bad news. He found out that it seems that we're on the internet, that we want to share uplifting stories. We want to read things that inspire us and bring us joy. As he said in his article, we don't want people to think we're a Debbie Downer. It's amazing. Because some of us would think that the human condition would be the opposite, that all we ever want to do is share bad news, that all we ever want to do is look at the bad side of things. And there are some cynical people in the world, and if you allow yourself from time to time to watch all of those cable news channels that now exist, you'll know that there's not a whole lot of good news among the stories. This very Advent season, just before we had the terrible tragedy in Paris and in our own country during the Advent season, a terrible, awful crime which people lost their lives at a Christmas party. That's the kind of news that dominates our world. But I think for a night, it is important that we share the good news. I think it's important for a night that we forget about the bad things. One of the famous jokes that comedians like to work around, one of the famous models for a joke, forms of a joke that comedians, it began to emerge in the 1960s. And these jokes fall into the good news, bad news category. Now, I tried to find some that were appropriate for church, and it took me a really long time. Because most of the good news, bad news jokes are not appropriate for church, but I found two that I think are. One of them happened in a church. Now, believe it or not, there were some good news, bad news jokes that happened in a church that weren't appropriate for church. But the first one was that, and this happened in a Baptist church because it would never happen in a Methodist church. The chair of the board of elders, after having met with the elders all day long, came into the pastor's study and said, "I have good news for you. The elders have accepted your job description just as you have written it." Pastor said, "That's fantastic. Then what's the bad news?" He said, "Well, the bad news is they immediately formed a search committee to find someone who could fulfill the job description." It's okay, you can laugh. I told it on myself. It's okay. And then this football season, at the end of the football season, always brings with it a coaching carousel. And so those of us who have spent some time between North Avenue and 10th Street had a good news, bad news kind of end to the season. Mark Richt had only lost twice in his tenure to Georgia Tech. He's undefeated at Grant Field. And so, the crazy thing is, I love Mark Richt. I was as angry as anybody that Mark Richt got fired. But down deep inside, I heard the good news is Mark Richt is no longer the coach of the University of Georgia Bulldogs. And then the bad news came. Now he's coaching in the ACC. When someone comes to you and says, "I have good news and I have bad news," which news do you want to hear first? Which news resonates with you? Which news do you want to stick in your soul? Which news is it that you want to share with other people? I believe that most, if not all of us, want desperately to share good news. Another popular saying is, you've got to take the bad with the good. And I want us to flip that upside down on Christmas Eve. I want us to say that we must find the good no matter how bad things might seem. Along those lines, one of the most sobering quotes I found about good news came from the diary of Anne Frank. She wrote at some point along the way in her diary, "Everyone has inside of them a piece of good news. The good news is that you don't know how great you can be. The good news is you don't know how much you can love. The good news is you don't know what you can accomplish. The good news is you don't know what your potential is." Our story tonight is full of good news. Because even though no one had an extra bed in their home, Mary and Joseph found a cave. And in that cave was a feeding trough. And they were able to clean it up. And the shepherds, did you notice who got the first news of the birth of Christ? It wasn't the elite. It wasn't those kept in highest regard. It was the shepherds who were told of the good news. And they went quickly. It says they went with haste. They went as fast as they could to see if the news was true. And once they knew that the news was true, they could not wait to share it with the world. This is a story that should be told, must be told. This is good news. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. We'll turn now to the sacrament of Holy Communion. You can find that again printed in your bulletin if you will be prepared to follow along with us. If those will be serving with me, if they will come forward as they already are, they're a step ahead of me.
Please join me for the great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You created light out of darkness and brought forth life on the earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets. You loved the world so much you gave your only Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Savior. As the angels sang glory to you in the highest and peace to your people on earth, so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. As Mary and Joseph went from Galilee to Bethlehem, and there found no room, so Jesus also went from Galilee to Jerusalem, and was despised and rejected. As in the poverty of a stable Jesus was born, so by the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. As your word became flesh, born of woman on that night so long ago, so on the night in which he gave himself up for us, Jesus broke the bread, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as holy and living sacrifices in union with Christ's offering for us as together we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, both now and forever. Amen. And now, with the confidence of the children of God, may we pray as Christ taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. In the United Methodist Church, we celebrate an open communion table. And what that means is that we recognize that this table doesn't belong to this church, nor does it belong to the United Methodist Church. This table belongs to God. Thus, all who are here are welcome and encouraged to receive in faith this greatest gift the world has ever known, the gift of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We share communion through intinction here. You'll be asked to come to one of two stations. As you do, as you approach that station, if you will, as you're able, extend your hands in the form of a cross. One of us will tear off a piece of bread, place it in your hand. If you'll take that bread and then dip it into the cup and then receive the sacrament. You're welcome to stay and pray along the altar rail and then return to your seats once you are through. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Lead us in O Holy Night. We will begin the beautiful tradition of lighting our candles. We'll come and we'll light the choir first, and then y'all have candles? No. No, we'll light up. Yeah, God gets. We'll light the choir first, and then we'll come out there. The key to this is you let the person next to you light their candle from yours. Don't try to tip yours when it's already burning and the wax comes off. And then as we sing the refrain, you'll be asked to sing the refrain along, Jessica, and then we will all sing together that beautiful hymn, Silent Night.
His gospel is me.
Later in her journal, Anne Frank wrote, "Look at a single candle, how it can both defy and define darkness. Defy and define. The light came into the world to defy the darkness, and the light defines the darkness, not the other way around. May we go forth in peace to share the good news, the gospel, that God came into the world to bring us life and love and peace and joy. May we go out into the world to defy the darkness. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit," and all God's family said, "Amen."